So hello everybody, I'm Felix Wemheuer, professor for modern China studies at the University of Cologne, and this is my YouTube channel, Studying Maoist China. And today we have a special guest, Zhou Xun here. She's a reader at the Department of History at the University of Essex in the UK. And we both share a common interest in the Great Leap Famine. And just to mention some of her publications, sure she got access to many classified material from provincial and county archives. So this book that came out with Yale University Press is The Great Famine in China, a documentary history. But she also did oral history research in 2013. She published this book, Forgotten Voices, of Mao's Great Famine, where she made interviews with survivors in the villages. But today we want to talk about her new book. It's just out now. It's called People's Health Intervention Delivery in Mao's China, 1949 to 1983. So welcome, Dr. Zhou Xun. Great that you are here.
Okay, I bought a copy of the book to show you.
Nice cover. Okay, I will start with the first question. So reading your book, I got the impression that people's health and campaigns to eradicate dangerous infectious diseases and epidemics played a central role on the agenda of the Communist Party after 49. Especially Mao was highly involved in campaigns such as a campaign against schistosomiasis. What were the reasons for the importance of public health for Mao and the Communist Party? And why was schistosomiasis identified as a major target in the 1950s?
Okay, thank you, Felix. Okay, I would even go back before 1949. Yeah, I think throughout the modern China, politics and health are intrinsically linked, I argue. So from the onset of the Chinese Revolution in the early 20th century, public health objectives were an integral part of ideology of revolution. The overwhelming poverty in China, which is linked to the poor hygiene and health of the Chinese population, singled China, you know, kind of to the world, China's backwardness to the world. Yeah, China was the sick man of Asia, Dong Ya Bing Fu, a very familiar term in many ways. So revolutionaries and the social reformers in China, but also Western medical missionaries and public health experts, you know, throughout the world, include, they actually, Rockefeller Foundation had funded a number of public health projects in China throughout, you know, kind of early part of the 20th century. And they believe that improving health and medical care of the Chinese people would therefore open the door for modernization. And Mao, you know, from very early on as young communist leader, he had understood this. He actually had drew some inspiration when he was still a branch leader, when he was working in Anyuan, amongst the miners. He had, and there was some, in Anyuan, there was, you know, kind of at the time when he was in Anyuan, there was some public health hookworm campaign funded by the Rockefeller Foundation. He had drew inspiration from that. So he became, came to understand that public health work could be utilized as a tool to win the support of the masses. And in 1933, you know, kind of when his mass warfare strategy was under criticism, you know, by the central leadership, and he had urged his comrades, you know, in Jiangxi, he was in Jiangxi in Jinggangshan at the time, to attend to ordinary people's everyday health needs. I have a quote here. This is what he said. He said, "Many people suffer from boils and other, you know, kind of illnesses. What are we going to do about it? All such problems concerning the well-being of the masses should be placed on our revolutionary agenda. We should convince the masses that we represent their interests, that our lives are intimately bound up with theirs. We should help them to proceed from these things to an understanding of the higher tasks which we have put forward, the tasks of the revolutionary war, so that they will support the revolution and spread it throughout the country, respond to our political appeals, and fight to the end for the victory in the revolution. Mm. So from very early on, he had placed, kind of give a higher purpose to medical and the health work. And so after the CCP seized power in 1949 and established a strong centralized communist state, the People's Republic of China, PRC, health had played an outside role in the internal politics of the new state. And in the same time came to, in a complex way to, define the PRC globally. Maybe I can talk about this a little bit later, but just stay with China at this point. So throughout, the Mao era, public health work came to be one of the central means of impacting and influencing the masses. Public health campaigns were spontaneous throughout the Mao era, I remember it very, very vividly. These public health campaigns were spontaneously political campaigns. And at the same time, the CCP leadership also understood the propaganda power of promise of health and healing. And historically in China, epidemics and together with war and this natural disaster were seen as, signs single of the loss of mandate of heaven. So, from that, that historical memory had meant, if you are able, or the failure to, control epidemics would, cast doubt on the legitimacy of the leadership, and therefore, eradicating diseases and improving people's health, had become a central pillar of, CCP's policies.
Yeah, maybe let me step in here. So I think in your book, this campaign against schistosomiasis plays quite a central role. So why was this disease so important? Maybe many people today in the UK or Germany would even not know what this is about. Why made Mao this kind of central point of his agenda?
Okay, actually, you mentioned Germany because in Germany, I think people know this disease as Bahadia. It was actually discovered in African strand of schistosomiasis was discovered by this German physician, and it was named after him. But so schistosomiasis it was a disease interrelated with the agricultural way of life. It in particular affected the rice growing farmers in the rice growing regions. So it was endemic in in the rice growing regions Anang and the south of Yangtze. Archaeological evidence actually dates the disease back to the second century in Hunan, Ma Wangdui discovery. The disease become quite prevalent. There's various reasons how the disease spread, but I'm not going, because we probably don't have time to go into that. In the first half of the 20th century, social reformers in China, many of them were Western trained public health experts. They came to see the disease and have contributed to infertility, no productivity. So they saw schistosomiasis as underlying cause for China's rural poverty. So some of them, like Chen Fengzi, he was one of the one of those experts. He had compared the disease. He labeled the schistosomiasis as a disease of national humiliation. Mm-hmm. And he argues that, it injured China's national economy as well as people's livelihood. Mm. So to control the disease, according to him, should be a shared responsibility for every Chinese person. And so then there was an incident that, when the communist army was crossing the Yangtze, trying to, unite or conquer the rest of the China, they had, encountered the disease. So thousands of soldiers, had been injured by the disease. And so that's how they first came into contact with the disease. And then very quickly they realized, make a commitment to tackle the disease, to try to control the disease, they can win the support of this local elite. So in a sense, it's a social capital for them, trying to take over this region and consolidate their rule in the schistosomiasis endemic regions. The schistosomiasis control, which linked to allopathic medicine and public health work, become part of the ongoing legitimization of the new power, and it allow them for, to give you some example, allow them to take over the existing, medical and public institutions, which left by the, nationalists. But so to incorporate them into the new system. But it also, allow, so schistosomiasis control also allow them to, mobilize as masses, so it's part of the tool for mass mobilization. And then as some time goes, then there's other things about, as schistosomiasis is a disease also affected, people in many parts of the underdeveloped world, So it was a thought for new China at this point, the thought that it would bring national prestige to this new communist state if China could be the first country to, control or even eradicate this. But I think the word eradication hasn't used at this point. It will come to 1955, when Mao was mounting the socialist high tide to bring the socialist revolution and or socialist storm, as he called it at the time. I think later on it was called socialist upsurge, to the Chinese countryside. He and the state council singled out schistosomiasis for it to be eradicated, because it was argued that the disease was result from the traditional way of life. So to bring socialist cultural revolution to the Chinese countryside, it will entail eradicating schistosomiasis by changing the prevailing custom and habits. And so it was decided that the national goal was to eradicate in 7 years by the end of the first 5-year plan.
Yeah, this would be my next question. So Mao promised the Chinese people to eradicate schistosomiasis. And there's also this book by Miriam Gross, Father to the God of Plagues, Mao's campaign to deworm China. And the argument of Miriam Gross is that the plan to eradicate the disease failed. However, in the early 1970s, the central government provided massive funds for the campaign and cheap medication for treatment could be produced. So as a result, schistosomiasis was not eradicated, but was brought under control and less harmful for the society and patient compared to the 1950s. Reading your book, I have an impression that you have a less positive evaluation of the campaign. So how does your argument differ from that of Miriam Gross?
Okay, I have to say it's very, I found her book quite intriguing. Because her book came out before I finished my book. And her, one of the things is about her methodology. She had, in her book, she admits, in the 1950s, the campaign had encountered a number of, problems. It was, there were many difficulties and complications. And she, for that part, chronologically, and she had accessed some archive material, mostly in Qinghu Jiangsu, and some of them from Jiangxi province. Yet, when she claimed it was successful in the 1970s, she relied entirely on published material. And many of them came from Western observers. And some of the Chinese published materials. Because this was a period when China had become, seen during the Cold War, China had become seen as a successful model. The Maoist and also the Bad for Doctor campaign was used as an example, by Western observers who cited the success of the Chinese example. Their image of China's success was largely ideological. Then the other thing is, she claims, her support evidence she uses to support it was a huge number of people. The production, the cheap availability of a new drug, which was first synthesized in China and had become used, and that had helped to reduce the mortality rates and morbidity rates, which there's a problem there. There's a problem there because there were certain success in certain region as I think one of the areas she focused was in Qingpu, which was very close to Shanghai. Qingpu was selected as a model. And Qingpu was very close to Shanghai. Actually, I knew the person, Su Dolong. She actually led the Qingpu campaign. These were what I call Potkin's village. They were so all the resources were put into those places, and they were used as a show case for foreign visitors. The success was made up in such a way. So there were five provinces who had become the model for this period of which is the Maoist control, and there were some success has been achieved, but throughout the country, if you look on other regions like Hunan, Hubei, the Lake region, or even Jiangxi. Jiangxi was claimed eradication in 1958. Obviously, that never happened. That was falsely claimed, but also in southwest, in Yunnan and Sichuan, the disease was no way under control at all, and the measures, the interventions used in the coastal regions, where they claimed to have some success, was not applicable to mountainous Sichuan because the typology is different, and also in the lake region because in the coastal region, in the canal, eastern China, the method they used was clean up the old canal, and to control the snails. But in the lake region, that wasn't possible because in the summer there's a land, but in the winter there's a land, but in the summer then all those land are submerged under the water. Once the water recedes, then the disease become then there's an outbreak of disease.
Yeah, maybe that brings me to the next question, because you're talking about local variations, right? And there's also this book here by Fang Xiaoping on the barefoot doctors, also using local archives. My impression is that you also used a lot of archives from Western China, right? This is a poorer region of China, and also the average life expectancy was about 10 years less than, for example, at the East Coast. So how do you deal with local variations? Cannot everybody found his or her example then to make the argument for success or failure?
Okay, I think one of the my perspective for this study is to show the variety of experiences. You can't use a local study to say this, you know, kind of this is the case for the whole of China. And what I try to say is, you know, kind of, the success is very much kind of based on sort of local agency, local resources. And then the, when you look at, you know, kind of the country on the whole, then the experience is very different. And then you can, then the other ways, I also try to show, you know, kind of there is a national picture, yeah? I use some for which is the Maoists, I use the reports from the national conferences. There is an, you know, kind of there's a national Maoist control conferences which holds you can more or less yearly, except during the Cultural Revolution period that was suspended. And so those reports are very telling because then they show the local you know, kind of problems, yeah. So how do you explain if the disease was under control in Jiangsu, for example, or in Jiangxi, how come, you know, kind of a couple of years later, there's a kind of huge outbreak? And so then they have to address these issues. Then it, then you get a in kind of an idea, you know, kind of in fact, many of those statistics, official statistics, were made up. And one of them, I don't know whether you read that, one of the Maoist called a grassroots called I interviewed in Hubei, she actually tells me kind of quite frankly, she said, you know, this is what we do, we make up of figures, yeah? And they want, because people, you know, kind of our superiors, they know this all along. It's not that we're cheating them. They know it because they want a good figure, yeah? Because they want to win the awards, yeah? They want to get the praises. And they it also entails money, yeah? Because the better you do, the better you come out from the annual evaluation, the more money you're going to get for next year.
But does this depend on the period, right? There maybe were periods during the early Great Leap Forward when the government only wanted to see success. And then the cadres did also this fake reports. But I think maybe later periods in the late 1960s and early 1970s, there maybe was more a general pressure not to report some kind of fantasy statistics.
Oh, it continued. It continued even today. I mean, COVID-19 is a perfect example. You know, kind of you don't report problems.
Yeah.
Yeah, you only report success, and success is often over-reported, and problem is under-reported. And so, I mean, this is a, you know, kind of part of the fragmentation of the system. It's not just public health, but, you know, many other areas. And it's also to do with how health work is funded. Yeah, they don't. So Ministry of Health, or now it's called, you know, kind of National Health Commission, yeah? They are the ones who formulate the policy or the guidelines, but they don't give money. Yeah, it's a state council subsidize, you know, kind of the health work. Or that money is not enough. So from local, and that money is also dependent on the performance. So the better you perform, the more money you're going to get next year.
Yeah.
And that would, so from local, you know, authority point of view, they are more in kind of inclined to report success.
Yeah.
And it's, sometimes you don't get caught. Yeah. If you're lucky, then there's no outbreak.
Now the church bell is ringing. We make a short break, okay?
Okay, all right. Yeah.
Okay, we can continue now with the last and the final question, how to evaluate public health under Mao. So your evaluation seems to be more negative than previous authors. And I fully agree that the Great Leap Famine was a terrible catastrophe for the Chinese peasant and also setbacks for many policies of the CCP, including public health. However, if you compare the situation before the People's Republic was founded, then to 76 when Mao died, do you admit that there are also some achievements of public health in the records. For example, according to official statistics from the 1980s, between the 1950s and 76, the infant mortality rate dropped rapidly, and average life expectancy increased from 40 years in 53 to 64 years in 76. And also some people argue about this transformation in health, that in the 1950s, most people would die of infectious diseases, but then later in the 1980s or 90s, dying from chronic diseases. This transformation was achieved in a very kind of short period of time. So what is your general evaluation of public health under Mao?
Okay. So I think it depends how you look at it. If you only use statistics, over the time, you will see there's an improvement. Yeah, the infant mortality, if you use mortality, infant mortality as only index, to measure the health outcome, then I think almost every country, even for Africa, you will see there is some, there is improvement over the time. But the question is, this is something which is debated in global health. Statistics, infant mortality and statistics, that's a kind of post-war sort of, ways of, kind of measuring improvement of health. Is that the only index used to measure, kind of improvement of health? And increasingly, I think medical anthropologists had argued, so save life is one thing. And then what kind of life? It's another matter. So one of the things I try to do is to move away from the statistical fetish and to move away from propaganda of health improvements and to move away from this kind of heightened focus on ideological model of measuring. And instead, I try to provide a more sort of nuanced account of the complex interrelationship between individual people and the health professions and the political and the state power. And then, the image, when you start putting people back into history, the image emerges quite different. So then you have, for example, I think one of the interviews, I remember one of the interviews I actually used for my book is in Vietnam, the barefoot doctor talking about, because the one of the things to, measure used to reduce infant mortality was introduced the modern medicalized birth method. So the villagers, many of them are from ethnic regions. They have their own cultures and ability and custom, etc. And they have found this method. They resisted the method because they don't feel, while the claim was it's safer for them, they didn't feel safe because to give birth in an alienated environment in the hospital, it was shameful. And it caused a lot of stress. And so there was one incident that, a home birth has caused complication. And so while the barefoot doctor did sort of perform the procedure in the end and saved the mommy, the mom and the baby, but the whole incident causes lots of stress for the entire family. And so that would have an impact on the well-being. So there's all kinds of this kind of when you have a bring people back into history and when you sort of see the human story of it, then it's different from statistics.
But maybe when you want to compare countries and measure achievements, then maybe such categories are important. For example, for Amartya Sen, average life expectancy is one of the three measurements to evaluate a human development. And actually, when you look at statistics in many sub-Saharan African countries, average life expectancy decreased in the last decades, and also US has the lowest life expectancy among the wealthy capitalist countries. So maybe this kind of categories cannot grab this local details and cultural variation, but can say something. And at least according to official statistics, average life expectancy, the performance of Maoist China is outstanding on a global level.
Then, I think there's also other things you have to. How do you study statistics data? Can you sort of study them on their own, or do you have to look at other statistics, other figures, and some? Because one of the things you have to convince infant mortality reduction of infant mortality rate, yeah. And the other thing is you have to look at the birth rates as well. Okay, because even if we don't talk about, from 1949, then you see gradual sort of reduction of infant mortality rates. But then the famine, during the famine period, yeah, there's hardly any birth. Yeah. And so how do you explain that? You have to, place into that context. But even if you take out the family, then there's other factors take into consideration. If you look at the birth rate, it still is going down. It's because women's status have changed. Their women's role had changed. Yeah. And women were encouraged to go outside, and to work. Yeah, and as a result, and there's less children were born, babies were born. Yeah. And that would impact on the infant mortality rate. Yeah. But then there's also a regional statistic. As we talked earlier with the schistosomiasis, but this would also apply as well. Because if you divide them up, if you look at the sort of like rural region, southwest, mountainous region, and if you compare with coastal region, and then the variation is huge, the gap is big. I think you have to take lots of different things into the consideration in order to get a more balanced picture.
So thank you. I think we should all read your book, and the issue is much more complex than many people think, and I hope we will also continue this discussion on public health under Mao. So this is a YouTube format, so we don't want to keep it too long. So Zhou Xun, thanks a lot for your time and this interesting discussion. So bye-bye.
Thank you, Felix. Thank you.
Bye-bye.